All right. Hey again, guys. I know you had a test yesterday or a quiz. We call them quizzes for chapter four. And you're just getting started on chapter five. But we do have a new lesson here today for your asynchronous day and an exit ticket. As well, so that's what you have for Thursday. Section 5.2, properties of proportions. Now, you know, we're putting that out there, proportions, and you see numbers in front of us, you only see shapes. It's because, again, we're not really getting to geometry quite yet this week. We're getting to some of the pre-work to really understand our new chapter, which is going to involve similar triangles. Okay, so I got an example of similar triangles. I've said it a few times here. Similar figures are figures that have the same basic shape, but different sizes, okay? So what you're gonna see is that angles are going to be congruent and sides are going to be proportional, right? Sides will be proportional. And that's why we're spending these two sections here. And you did enough last section, right? Did the classroom exercises, did the exit ticket, that's fine. This is a slightly more important section because it's gonna give you really looking down the things you can do with proportions and different statements of equivalency and equations you can set up given a certain proportion. And proportions are super important when it comes to similarity, right? Because if these sides are in proportion, right? Let's say that, you know, this side right here is a side length 6 and that side length is 9, right? That's kind of like, you know, if this side length were 2, that side length would be 3, right? They would be in a 2-to-3 ratio, right? 6-to-9 ratio, because that would reduce to 2/3, right? By both by 3, you'd get 9 divided by 3 is 3. Anyways, 6 divided by 3 is 2. Anyways, 6 to 9 is the same as a 2 to 3 ratio, right? This side here also would have to be in that 2 to 3 ratio, right? So if this is 4.5, right, this would be 3, right? We'd figure that out. You know, different rules we'll have to follow. Different mathematical operations we'll have to work with, proportions to solve for unknown lengths and whatnot. We'll do that a bit later, okay? I'm going to delete this similar diagram here because, again, as I told you that, we're not going to be doing really looking at figures really this first week or so in our new chapter. So I'm going to delete this right now, and then we're going to talk about these properties of proportions during this lesson. Looking forward to it, and we're going to do some cool, interesting stuff here with proportions coming up first. See you guys on the other side. Section 5.2, properties of proportions. There are some vocabulary words related to the outer terms and inner terms of a proportion, okay? So just to remind you, this is a proportion because they're equal ratios, right? Proportions are equal ratios. A to B is the same as C to D, okay? 6 to 9 is the same as 6 to 9, there we go. It's the same as 2 to 3, okay? And this here, right, would get written as this, right? This here, 6 to 9 is the same as 2 to 3, right? Would be 6 to 9. Right, is the same as 2 to 3, right? 2/3. 6/9 is the same as 2/3. Okay, so there are some vocabulary words I want to talk about right now. Okay, some vocabulary words to talk about. As our very first thing, put these in your notes. You need to know what the means are, and you need to know what the extremes are, okay? And I'm trying to change my color right here so I can work in black when I'm talking about the means and red when I'm talking about the extremes here, okay? So if you look at this here, 6 to 9 equals 2 to 3. 6/9 equals 2/3. The means are related to the inner terms, okay? The inner terms. So I put that in your notes. The means are the inner terms of the proportions, okay? Meaning, right, the ones that are close to the equal sign right there, right? Terms 2 and 3, right? Terms 2 and 3 would be the means here, okay? Terms 2 and 3. So if we're thinking about kind of the means, where does the word mean come from in math? You guys heard the word mean in math before? I'm guessing you calculate the mean of two values or the mean of two values. Yeah, mean is the average, right? In between. Mean in the math means middle, right? Middle here, okay? So when we're talking about our mean terms, okay, this will be important later because we'll have something called the means extremes property. We'll also have something called the mean swap when we do this in a second. So know what we're talking about, that when we're talking about the means of a proportion, we're talking about positions 2 and positions 3, right, in the middle here. Remember, we have four positions, position 1, 2, 3, and 4, 2 and 3 are the means, that's it, okay? So if we look at this here, this is where my means are. These are my means in this one, okay? Those are my means, right? They're my means. The means are the middle ones, 2 and 3, okay, close to the equal sign here, okay? Extremes, what are extremes in math, right? What are some extreme values? If your teacher says, hey, what are some like really extreme values? You'd think of really, really big values, really, really huge positive values, or maybe very extremely negative values, okay? So your extremes in math are things that are located way away from one another. Okay, that's what the word extreme really means in math, if you had to get down to it. So what your extremes are, right? Know what your means are. Those are positions 2 and 3. Extremes are positions 1 and 4. Put that in your notes. We're starting off boring like usual here, right? Like usual here. If those are my means right here, this is my first extreme, and this is my second extreme, okay? Positions 1 and 4, okay? Means were right there. Extremes are pretty far away from one another, and we'll get some properties in a second about this here. This is another extreme. All right, extremes are the outer, right? Outer terms. 6 to 9 equals 2 to 3. Well, then 6 and 3, those are the last two I've been said. They're extremely away from one another. That must be the extremes if we're talking about. Those are terms 1 and terms 4, okay? That's going to lead us into something here. I want to get those vocabulary words in here because it turns out these means can move together a lot. These extremes can move together a lot, and that's what we need to see going into our next slide, which is properties of proportions. Let's get into it. Okay, Do we do enough of this here? Maybe I'll do one more here for you. Let's tell me about this here real quick. Who's going to be the first person to tell me? Guys, I got to like drag it out and be right here. What about, let's get another one here. 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. Okay, what's 8 to 10? Well, where are my means? Well, actually, it turns out here, look, my means are actually pretty close to one another. That's what might just be coincidental. Is that always going to be true? No, if this were smaller, right? If those were really small numbers, it'd be an episode of 4. So anyways, that's not always the case here. 5 and 8 are my means, and 4 and 10 are extremes. Sometimes just seeing one more example is kind of, important to you to kind of put out here. Anyways, 5 and 8, and actually, what do we notice about this, actually? Come to think of it a second. One observation before we get into properties and proportions. What's 5 times 8? What's 5 times 8? 5 times 8 is 40. You got to know your multiplication tables. What's 4 times 10? Oh my God, 4 times 10 is also 40, and that's going to get me to my first property of proportions. That's right. Okay, so it turns out here that there are 4 properties of proportions. That's right. 4 properties of proportions that we're going to learn. You got to know each of them. We're going to come up with some nicknames for these properties of proportions, but basically, we're going to take that, right? A over B equals C over D, right? A to B equals C to D. We're going to take that, and we're allowed to move things around to create new equivalent, right? Equivalent proportions. In Algebra 1 right now, I'm talking about equivalent equations, right? Multiply both sides by 2, divide both sides by 2, equivalent equations. We're talking about equivalent equations that deal with proportions, deal with ratios, and other ways we can rewrite that. And that's what the property of proportions is going to be, and we're going to go through each right now. They're going to involve movements of the means and extremes, movement of numerators, denominators, and other things we can do. Like we can look at the denominator of a proportion, add them together, right? So if we think about like what we just had on the last slide, this is going to be a property of proportions. I'm just going to tease what it is you're going to have to pay attention to today, right? 4 over 5 equals 8 to 10. Well, if that's a true statement here, check this one out. This is going to blow your mind. Well, then 9 over 5 would also equal 18 over 10. What did I do right there? What did I do? That's true. Look at this here. 9 over 5, double it, you got 18 over 10. That's a true statement here. 9 parts to every 5 parts, same as 18 parts to 10 parts. What did I do there? Well, if I take the 5 and I add it to 4, that's 9. Take the 10, add it to 8, that's 18. So 18 over 10, and so our denominators didn't change, but I added my denominators to numerators. You're allowed to do that. That's something called I just call it informally the denominator add property of proportions here. And we'll talk about why that's true, why that kind of happens. Pretty neat, right? Things here, moving around proportions. So we want to move quickly, right? When we get to the geometry, we want to make observations quickly and know how to move the stuff around algebraically here. Okay, so that's what we're going to do now in this. Without further ado, let's go ahead and see these 4 properties of proportions. Boom! Okay, all going to have to deal with this generic, okay? So what we're going to do here, we're going to go through each. That's the basic idea about this lesson today, is we're going to figure out how to rewrite this generic proportion. A to B equals C over D. How can we move things around? How can we move the extremes around, right? How can we move A and D around in places? Well, what we have to do with the means. Or if the means move around, well, we have to move extremes around, other stuff like that, okay? What you might see below it, this is all on page, I don't know, it's on page for the section 5.2. You can find it. I know you can find it here. There's also one more property proportions down here that involves adding numerators and denominators of an extended proportion. We'll get to that later, but just like you had a property of inequalities that you were able to use in proofs, in section 4.6, you're going to be able to use a property of proportions in proofs all throughout chapter 5. Look forward to it. That's right. Look forward to it here. Okay. So we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4 properties of proportions, right? I can take this thing and it's going to be equivalent to this statement, that statement, that statement, that statement. And you're going to use those. You're going to look at those this chapter. And then there's also going to be another property of proportions. They basically a fifth one here, but that deals with an extended proportion. Here we can generalize A to B equals C to D equals E to F. There's going to be some sort of generalization we can make here when we have more than two ratios strung together that are all equivalent, we can make another equivalent statement, which we'll see a little bit later here. Okay. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get a little preview of what's going on. And then we're going to go through each one individually. Fascinating. I think so. Let's do this. Okay. So check this one out here. I got A to B equals C to D. That's equivalent to what? And that is this. Whoa. Mind blown. We got here. A to B is the same as C to D. If you look at this here, if you're really quick here, how can you justify this? Well, hey, cross multiplication. Remember cross multiplication from middle school? I don't know. In algebra one, people have trouble with cross multiplication a little bit. So I'm not sure. I want to take you through it. Lots of cross multiplying happening in geometry here, right? Multiply A to D, AD, C to B, BC. You're allowed to do it. Why are you allowed to do it? I'm going to talk you through it. I'm going to get you there, hopefully. Here's another thing we can say. Check it out here. A to B equals C to D. If I knew this is true, right? 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. Then I would also know, wait, 4 to no longer 5. 4 to 8 equals 5 over 10. Wait, 4 to 8 equals 5 over 10. That's true. One half. What the heck happened here? What? So this is also another property. Freaking cool, huh? I can move my means. I can swap my means. We're going to call that the mean swap informally. Okay? We're going to see why that's true. It's part of today's lesson as well. All right. Anyways, keep it on moving. Hopefully you're putting these to your notes and we'll write the proofs below them next time and you'll get them. Good to go. But hey, you just need to know them, right? You really know them. And hopefully you're watching this video and you're getting them here. Another statement I could say is this. Check it out here. So I got A over B equals C over D, right? If I got 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10, right? Because they do. Those would be both 8 to 10 is a 4 to 5 ratio simplified. This was simplified here. 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. Well, that would be the same as 5 over 4 equals 10 over 8. Right? 5 over 4, that's like 1.25. 10 over 8 is 1.25. What? I'm allowed to do that? We'll talk about how that gets justified. We will. We'll definitely do that today. Okay? So that is, right, we're allowed to flip the fractions. If we have two ratios equal to each other, you're allowed to flip them, right? You're allowed to do that. I'm letting you do that, right? You know what? I'm not letting you do that. Math is letting you do that, right? And hopefully understand why and how it connects together, right? So I'm finding connections here. Finally, we got part D. Check it out. Well, this is the thing that I showed you a little bit earlier here. Another thing you're allowed to do, if I have 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10, then I know that 9 over 5 is going to equal 18 over 10 because I'm allowed to add my denominator. But something you can do. This is going to be important here. Number D is going to be important here when we have conclusions about parts to parts being in ratio. We can also make comparisons about wholes to parts being in a in proportion, right? I should have said proportion, not ratio. So part to part is in ratio. This part has a common ratio and two similar figures. Then the wholes, right? Perimeters to parts will also be in, we can also compare them between the two shapes to be in the same ratio and therefore in proportion to one, that kind of thing here. Okay, so we'll go over that as well here. Number two, let's see if we got number two. That's that one more property portion involves adding numerators and denominators of an extended proportion. Booyah, Kasha. Here we go. We got this. A over B equals C over D equals E over F. Then, right, if we have this, they're all in a common ratio together, right? 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. Equals, I'm just saying this 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10 as an example, equals 12 to 15, then, right, this is a conclusion we can make, is that, wait, we can add all of the numerators here and all the denominators here, and the result is going to be in that common ratio. Ooh, interesting, okay? So anyways, 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10 equals 12 to 15, well, 4 plus 8 12 plus 12 is 24. 24, what was the other one? 5 plus 10 plus 15 is 25. So that would be, I lost track of what I'm talking about. 24, I don't know. Anyways, we'll get to this one. We'll give an example here. All right, anyways, let's just move on here. We got properties and proportions, okay? We'll go through each one individually, write the proofs. Hopefully you're watching this. You gotta know these properties and proportions. Why I felt the need to to spend the half hour with you guys here today. Hopefully this only takes a half hour to justify which of these are true, because you got to know all these, right? Property proportions. I want to move some stuff around. What is the most common thing you think you've done so far with a proportion like this? This over that equals this over that is equivalent to what? There we go. There we go. We got cross multiplication this year, but your book calls it something different. This is something you need to know. It's called the means extremes property of proportions and proofs. Okay. So this is, you can, if you want to use this one, you can say a property of proportions and proof. Anything I'm going to go through with you today, you can say property proportions and proof. For some reason, since this one is used so much, your textbook sometimes says a property proportions when they do this. Other times they say the means extremes property. Okay, so we need to talk about a justification for this one. But the idea is, in case you haven't picked up what I'm trying to tell you right here, is that if you have A to B equals C to D, so like 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10, it's going to be equivalent to, if you multiply your means, look, check it out here, BC are your means, right? BC, right? Those are the ones that are like closest to one another. A to B equals C to D, right? Well, what's in my middle? Mean means middle in math. B to C are the means. So B times C is going to equal my extremes. A to B equals C to D. What are we away from one another? A and D. So AD equals BC. They multiply together. Okay. So the means times by the extremes actually equal one another. It's pretty neat here. 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. 5 times 4 is 20. Wait, hold on. 4 to 5 equals 8 to 10. 5 times 8 is 40. And 4 times 10, which is the extremes, is also 40. And so that is actually true. So inductively, it's true. But you know me, we can't really rely on the inductive. When mathematicians, they don't want to rely on inductive. They want to prove things that it's irrefutable. You can't argue with me. It's because you can argue with somebody if you just observe something. Even if you observe it 100 times, it might not always be true. But if you have good rules in math, we can actually prove this. So let's prove this right now. Justification is, why does the means extremes property work? And you shouldn't have been doing that. You should have been going to the pen to this here. But let's get this. Why does the means extremes property, why does it work out? And I need a better color than green. Green is not my favorite. It's not my cup of tea here. Pen color. Let's go with blue. Okay, let's check it out here. Well, I'm going to move this down. Why am I allowed to do this? Let's see this one here. Okay, I'm allowed to take this. I'm allowed to do A times D times B times C. That's going to be my answer. So that's my goal here is to, right, if we have this, okay, then I want to prove that AD would have to equal BC. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. Okay, so I'm going to do A over B equals C over D, because that's our given premise. Okay, that's what we're given to. If this is true, then that's going to have to be true. Okay, and how can I do this? Well, this is cross multiplication. What if I actually just multiply, use multiplication property of equality? So check this out. If I have this here and I multiply both sides by B, what's going to happen? Okay, what's going to happen here? Well, this is A over B times by B. Well, that's B over 1, right? So this would be B over A divided by B. And wait a second. B divided by B, well, that makes a 1 too. A over 1, well, that's just A. Okay, this would equal A equals, well, now I have B times by C over D. That doesn't really simplify, so this is B over 1. Denominators multiply, numerators multiply. That's how you multiply fractions. You remember that, right? You remember that. Okay, this is going to be B times by C over D. Okay, and what is that? That's the multiplication property of equality. Okay. And here, look at that. I got BC on one side of an equation. Okay, I want to get BC equal to AD. How would I do that? Well, what can I do? Multiplication property again. I could do D multiply to the right side, multiply to the left side. What's D divided by D? That's 1. And now I have BC equaling to what's D times by A? It's DA, or use the commutative property of multiplication. Remember, if you're multiplying things, order doesn't matter. So then you're going to have AD equaling BC. And there we go. QED, we're good to go. Okay. Therefore, right, this symbol here, these three dots here, means therefore, right? We said all this. Well, we knew that A over B equals C over D because that was our given premise. We knew if you multiplied both sides by B, it would cancel out the B on the left. We'd have a B over here. That's a multiplication property of equality. We can use multiplication property of equality again to cancel out that D, multiply D to both sides. And voila, what do we end up with after we do the multiplication property of quality there is we end up with maybe say commutative property if we're writing every little last step here, rearrange it here. Therefore, what we wind up with? Well, AD's got to equal BC. So now we've proven it, right? So now what we can do is use this idea of cross multiplication, right? Of cross multiplication to really process, right? Rewrite any kind of proportion that we have here, okay? So now if we start with this, then we can jump to, right, BC. B times C equals A times by D, okay? You guys remember cross multiplication, okay? There's a justification for here using the multiplication property of quality. It's what I just did here. Okay, so let's keep going here. So that was one. That was the first remember, you can call that a proof. You can call that property of proportions. You can call it the means extremes property. Or you can even call it cross multiplication. I'll allow that here too. All right, anyways, another thing. Check it out. Let's do this. Yes. All right, A over B equals C over D is equivalent to A over C equals B over D. Okay, pretty neat. Pretty neat here. All right, what do we call this nowadays? We're calling this informally as the mean swap. Put it in your notes, okay? Property proportion. First one, means extremes property. What did it do, right? Show what I've got arranged, right? I rearranged. Second property proportions, mean swap. Sorry, not mean. It shouldn't be mean swap. It should be means swap. Sorry about that here. Because the idea of this is that you got your means here, right? A over B equals C over D. If you have a proportion, two of those terms, right? Just a regular proportion, not an extended proportion. Two of those terms have got to be your means. You're allowed to just move them. Look, check it out here. We had A over B equals C over D. And now we got A over C equals B over D, right? So 4 over 5 equals 8 over 10. Well, if I swap my means, that would be 4 over 8 equals 5 over 10. They both equal 1/2. What? I'm allowed to just do that, right? I can just do that? Yes, you can. You can totally do that here. And so let's do that with the justification right now, okay? So before you miss me here, this should have been called the means swap, right? We'll call it the means swap. That's what I call it. We got a means swap. We're allowed to means swap, okay? But why? Why are we allowed to switch around those means here, okay, right? Otherwise, right, here is our justification. Here's the mirror proof is that if we have a proportion, and again, this is just a generic one, so we can prove it for all proportions, AB equals C over D, then we would also know that, right, those means are interchangeable, right? We can change them around and we could have a valid statement, right? If this is a valid statement here, then that's got to be a valid statement here, okay? Why? How are we going to prove it? And I will prove it for you right here, okay? Step one, we got our given A over B equals C over D. There's my given premise. What am I going to do to that given premise to actually kind of like justify this, kind of get this here? Well, there's our given. What can I do is that I can actually do the means extremes property, right? What I explained to you in the last slide, what I proved to you. So we got the means extremes property. And if I did that, right, if I did the means extremes property, remember, means extremes property, that's just cross multiplication, okay? So I'm going to switch to red color here so we can see the means extremes property very clearly right here, is that I can take this, multiply them together. I can take A times D, multiply them together. And what do I get? I get AD is equaling to BC, and that's by the means extremes property. And how does that help me? How does that help me get to this here? What can I do now? What can I do? I can do what? Well, I want to get A and B in the numerator, right? A and B is currently the numerator. I want to get D and C in the denominator. What can I do to both sides? I can divide both sides. Yeah, division property of equality is going to get me to completing this mean swap right here. So check it out. If I do this next, right, you don't have to follow every step I'm doing, but you maybe see it just unfold and be like, wow, this just works. This guy's pretty good at this stuff here. So let's check it out here. If I divide this by D over here and I'd have to divide that side by D, okay? Remember this, we're doing the division property of equality. If I divide one side by a certain value, I would have to divide the other side by an equivalent value, right? D equals D, sure, I'm allowed to do that here, and it remains balanced. D divides by D, those would cancel out here. Now I got B over D, that's nice. That's what I'm trying to prove in my mean swap, the resultant kind of equivalent equation here. But now I have C, I gotta get rid of that. So you know what, I'm actually divide by C here. Get rid of it. If I divide one side by C, I divide the other side by C, and my equation remains balanced here. Okay, so let's divide this over here by C, and up, there we go, we got it. A over C equals B over D. So I'll just write that in as a final answer. And what moved, right? This is just, we're just justifying we're allowed to move some things around. What moved were my means, okay, were my means here. Because instead of having my B, my term two as B, Now my term three is B, okay? Instead of having C as my term three, C is now my term two. The means just swapped. Positions two and three just moved, and that it's valid. Look, I've justified all of it right here, okay? Through these steps, starting with that proportion, just through the means extremes property, which I proved for you in the last slide, division property of equality, and boom. Starting with this, we're allowed to move exactly to that. So this is proven. If this, then that, right? That we're allowed to move these means around and we're good to go. Okay? You see how this is going? Hey, this isn't so bad. Just like justifying some things we're allowed to do. And this will be important when we are kind of doing something like going from like one side length to another side length and then one side length to another side length. And now all of a sudden we want to compare that side length to this side length here. Anyways, there'll be some reasons why we'll need to do this a little bit later. And also just you want to learn math, right? You want to learn the limits that equations have provided us here. And this is all valid. This is proven for us here. I'm proving it for you. Just somebody else proved it for me. It's just how the things go as we try to get more things proven. Okay, if you're not keeping count at home, you've maybe written down the justifications for two of the four properties of proportions. Remember, we're going to have that fifth one here too. This is the one that involves A over B equals C over D. Here's another thing it involves is this. It would be equal to that. Okay? All right, let's do this. Why not? Okay, we'll refer to this one as formally as invert both fractions. Okay, you're allowed to, if we have two ratios that are equal to another, meaning that it makes a proportion, you can just flip both of those ratios and it will still make a proportion. That's it, simple as that. Justification, okay, right? So here, yeah, just check it out here. A over B just became B over A. C over D just became D over C. We would know it's a true statement. It has to be a true statement. Okay, justification. Well, there are a lot of ways we can justify this one. I'll justify the most, not the quickest way, but the most simple way for you is, you know, I could just maybe do it this way. Justification, again, I'm trying to do this. If A over B equals C over D, my goal is I want to show that then, right? I just flip the fractions that, yeah, right? That's going to have to be a true proposition that we have here, okay? So, right, if I do this, because it's given to me, right? That's the given premise of this if-then statement, right? If this is sort of where I begin, this is where I'm going to end, this is where I'm going to get to. We got given right here. How can I do this? Well, I can do the means extremes property, right? Do that here. And I get A over D, A times D equals B times by C, okay? And that's the means extremes property. In a proof, you can just say properties of proportions. That's what we're learning. All this stuff, in a proof, just say properties of proportions. So means extremes property, okay? But I'll put it down here. But again, right, that's cross multiplication. BC times by AD. And that was justified why you could do that earlier, right? You just gotta be comfortable with that. It's been justified for you. You're allowed to multiply positions two and three together as long as you're multiplying positions one and four together and you're gonna maintain that equality, as we have that represented down here, okay? So now, how can I get to this where I've inverted the original fractions? Well, I can just, instead of dividing by D, I can divide by A, both sides. Goes away. Instead of, right, I wanna get C down here, I'm gonna divide this side by C. Goes away, divide this side by C, and check it out, wait. Oh, okay, yeah. D over C equals B over A, right, move it down. So what I did there was the division property of equality. Okay, and here, look at this. I basically already stated this right here. B over A equals D over C, right? This is B over A equals D over C. So is equal to, right? You'd read that from left to right. So you can do this here. I don't know if you guys remember this. This was only written out in the book like really early on in the year. This is something called the symmetric property, okay? Equality allows for symmetry. This is equal to that is the same as that is equal to this, right? Order, like the side of the equality doesn't matter. Unlike an inequality, right? A greater than symbol. If this is greater than that, then that isn't greater than this, right? That doesn't make any sense. So anyways, here, just so I can get it to look like what I have after the then here, right? Start with this. The goal was to get to that, right? I could have ended here. That's fine. I don't require a symmetric property. But just to remind you, in case you're wondering, wait, I haven't said the exact conclusion yet of this if-then statement. I just used the premise and I've gotten close to it. You can justify it through this symmetric property of equality, okay? If you wanna get it to look exactly what your conclusion looks like here. All right, we're keeping going. This is it, it's all good, right? Just take it on in. You'll get some exit tickets coming up in a little bit here. You just gotta learn these properties proportions. We'll apply them later to shapes. Okay, A over B equals C over D is equivalent to, hey, there we go. I think I've already told you this one year. Okay, so this is kind of a neat thing. This will be something, again, when we're trying to, when we're analyzing here, we might have a part to part ratio, right? Think back to those original triangles I show you. A 6-to-9 ratio is the same as a 2-to-3 ratio. But perhaps we want to, like, look at some, the perimeters, I don't know, the whole, like, the two sides to one side ratio. I don't know why we look at that here. So we can take 6-to-9 equals 2-to-3. Equals 2-to-3 is the same as 15/9 is equal to 5/3, right? Because I added 3 to the 2 up there. So 5/3 and 15/9. Yeah, 15/9 is in a 5/3 ratio. So anyways, what I'm trying to get at here is we'll refer to this property proportions informally as denominator add. We can take those denominators we see, B and D, and hey, we can add them to the numerator, and that, like, B and D, like we have right here, we add them to the numerator, and that would set up a, not an equivalent proportion, but, well, I guess equivalent says equivalent to, it would just be a another true equation here. If this original proportion were true, then this resultant proportion of adding the denominators would also have to be true, okay? How do we justify that? Well, hey, you're looking at the right person. You came to the right place if you wanted to know why this was true, right? If you wanted to know why this was true. So let's go ahead and do this and get it done here. Okay, so if I got this, if A over B equals C over D, then let's add those denominators, A plus B. You know, it helps just be writing along with me. I know these are long, but, like, you know, you're just like, oh, do I really got it? And then you write it, and you're like, okay, that's making a little more sense because I'm writing up here. Like, that's the way that I find it, okay? C plus D over D, right? This is what we want to prove, okay? Again, start with my given premise of this. That's the hypothesis of this if-then statement. It's what we're going to start with, and then we're going to prove this is going to have to follow as a necessary thing that follows here. Okay, so there's my given premise. Okay, how I'm going to prove this? This actually relies on something called the identity property of multiplication. Okay, this is what the identity property is. Okay, this is this here. It's A over B, and I'm going to multiply this side and this side. Well, but actually, this is technically multiplication property of equality right now. Well, actually, you know, I kind of have trouble with my wordings of this one here, but check it out here. Identity property is I can actually multiply this by 1, and that would still equal C over D. Why? You multiply anything by 1, what's it going to become? Well, it's going to become the same thing, okay? So anyways, bear with me for a second. You might be like, why am I doing this here? And this actually isn't the identity property. Yeah, this is just multiplication property. Well, I'm going to multiply 1 to the left side, and I'm going to multiply 1 to the right side. Okay, so I'm going to do this. C over D times by 1. Okay, and you might be, like, thinking, like, what is this leading to? How is this helping me? So let's check this out. Like, what? Okay, so multiplication prop of equality. Okay, and maybe actually, you know what? I think I know where the identity property is this. And this is going to be in the very next step. Wait, check it out. Wait, I did a 1 here, times by 1 here, because actually, wait, I want to add 1. No, I want to add, oh, that's it. I want to add 1 to both sides. Oh, I got this proof wrong here. I'm going to add 1 to both sides. That's what I wanted to do. Let's see, because I want to add B and add D. So anyways, maybe just, like, fast forwarding me. I don't need this. I think I get this here. It's fine. So let's add one. Okay, so this is the addition property of equality. Okay, and I want to add 1 here, and I add 1 here because that's what's going to help me. I want to add B here. But technically, if you're adding B to this A right here, adding B to this A, adding C to that A, you're not just adding C, right? Like, what's C over? C is over D. B. Sorry, you're adding B over here. You're adding D over here, but yeah, D is over D. B is over B, okay? So I added 1 to both sides because I want to change that. Like, check it out here. Bear with me for a second, right? Stay with me. See if you can peep this. You can follow this here, okay? So, not cyan. I don't want that. Hi, cyan, by the way. But anyways, we'll change to blue. We got A over B plus, and I'm going to change this to B over B. Whoa, mind blown. What was B over B originally? Well, B over B was plus 1. Okay, plus 1. I can justify this. B over B is equivalent to 1 because that's the identity property. This is called the identity property of division. Okay, any number right? Yeah, where did I learn these properties? Well, they were written out in Algebra 1 textbook. They're there, right? But we don't spend a lot of time on them in Algebra 1 here. But the idea with identity property is that any number divided by itself is equal to what? It's equal to 1, right? It's equal to 1. So if I have a 1 here, I can rewrite 1 in disguise by, right, a number divided by itself, right? That's equivalent to 1. It's equal to 1. So the identity of 1 or identity, like the identity properties, I can take this and divide it by itself. It's going to become 1. Its identity is itself, right? So divided by itself becomes 1. Use its identity to get to 1 or vice versa. That's how we're going to use that here. So I do this, and this is important here. I might just show you why it's important, but you probably get this here. Numerators, right? How do we add fractions? Well, we have a common denominator, so we can just move that A plus B together in the numerator. And that's all being divided by B. That's the same thing. These mean the same thing here, right? A plus B over B, right? The B is getting divided by B. The A is getting divided by B. So why not? Why not A plus B divided by B? It works, right? It works out here, okay? So I'll do that. I'll do this over here, C over D. What am I replacing the 1 with? Who's going to jump in here? Cyan, is it you? No, anyways. 1 is going to be plus D over D, right? D over D. Hopefully you got that, right? This 1, is this here? Is it in disguise? And this is just going to justify why we're allowed to do this, okay? The identity property, we introduced the D over D thing. Now we can just add. Right? That's just simple addition of fractions. Okay, so I'll justify that through addition. And voila, we have it, QED. Therefore, symbol, we've justified what it was we were trying to prove. Okay, starting with this, we know that that follows from it. Okay, so what that means is that if we have the proportion, then we're allowed to add the freaking denominators to it. And it's going to create an equivalent correct proportion. And we're good to go. There it is, number 4. You've made it through the 4 main ones. Okay, you made it through the 4 main ones. Hey, there's this one here. This one is like, if you look at this in the C-level problems, I think number 41, it's like, try to justify this. The justification, the proof of this is kind of confusing, so I don't want to spend time going over it with you guys right now. It'd be the kind of thing that I would sign for you as a homework problem, and then like 3 people would get it, and then maybe we'd go over it afterwards. That's how I see that going, but I don't think I assign it to you this year. Maybe I do. I don't know. But check it out here. Let's just do this inductively. Let's check this out just so we understand exactly what the statement's saying. This is saying that if you have an extended proportion, right? If you have an extended proportion, if you have extended proportion, actually, you know what? I think I write this out for you guys in a second. I don't need to actually write it out here. If you have an extended proportion, then the sum of all the ratios, right? Sum of all the ratios, numerator and denominators, is going to be equal to that original ratio. Right, it's going to be equal to the same ratio. So you can actually add all these numerators here, add all the denominators together, and it would be equivalent here. Okay, so let's maybe check this one out. Boom. Okay, we're going to refer to this informally as adding the extended proportion. We can add all the numerators of an extended proportion, all the denominators of an extended proportion. That's just going to allow us to make what in geometry, what's going to make it allow us to make a conclusion on is that if you have an extended proportion where all the side lengths are in proportion with one another of two different polygons. This is going to allow us to justify that the perimeters are also in that same ratio, right? That are all in the same ratio that exists in the original proportion. Okay, so kind of like writing out, like if somebody's just like, what is this here? I need to write this out here. In an extended proportion, if I have this, the ratio of the sum of all the numerators, right? A plus C plus D plus E. To the sum of all denominators, B plus D plus F, and so on and so forth, right? We have more things that are here, right? We're adding together. It's going to be equal to any ratio in the extended proportion, okay? If A over B is the most simplified, then that would be maybe the good thing here, okay? So maybe let's go to maybe show you an example of this is, for instance, yeah, blue's good here, is maybe the triangles I was talking about at the very beginning, if you think back to the beginning of this lesson, we had triangles that were like, just like, well, pretend this is in a 6-9 ratio, then these other side lengths, right, would be in a 2-3 ratio, let's say, and another one, I think I said like 4.5 over 3, I don't want to do decimals for this one, I'm going to keep it a little bit easier for you guys here, so let's go a little bigger here, so let's go 2 or 3, let's see, 12 over,
why am I freaking out here? Eight, yeah, don't worry. What am I thinking here? I do 4/6. Do 4/6. I think 4/6 is better. Okay. So what if I have a? So here's my smaller triangle. Here is a 6-2-4 triangle. It's similar to a 9-3-6 triangle. You'll hear all about this a little bit later. Okay. These are all true, right? Because 6-9 is in a 2-3 ratio. 2-3 is in a 2-3 ratio, and 4-6. That's two parts for every three parts you have here, right? Double it, it works out here. What about the perimeters? Right, perimeters, what's their ratio like here, okay? So what you can do, it turns out what you can do is you can take all this information, you can add 6 plus 2 plus 4, okay? That's an enumerator of the fraction from applying this. This rule here, which we'll just accept. Let's not prove this because that's like not worth our time and focus at this point. 6 plus 2 plus 4 over 9 plus 3 plus 6. It's going to equal the same ratio as what you guys have here. It's going to be in 2-3 ratio. Check it out. Let's simplify this. 6 plus 2 is 8 plus 4 is 12. And that's going to be over 9 plus 3 is 12 plus 6, which is 18. And look at that. What do we know about 12 over 18? Right. Well, that would simplify to 6-9, and there we go. We got 6-9 right there. And it would simplify further, right, because they're both divisible by 6, right? 12 divided by 6 is 2. 18 divided by 6 is 3. So there we go. Right, and we doubled it, it would equal that, okay? So we can add all the numerators of an extended proportion and divide all the denominators of an extended proportion, and it would be in the same ratio as the original proportion. Pretty neat stuff. Example here, use this process. This is similar to kind of the examples that you have in the problem set tonight, okay? Use the proportion x over y equals 3/4 to complete each statement. So let's check this one out. Let's just do them together. And then, hey, you should just go to your exit ticket right after this. Make this one blue, okay? 3y is going to equal what? Well, here we go. It must be cross-multiplying, right? There we go. 3y equals 4x. Good to go. They cross multiplied. What rule is being used here? It looks like they're doing denominator add in this rule here. So let's do x plus y over y is going to be the same thing as, well, I just added my denominator here. Let's do 3 plus 4 over 4. Okay, what's that going to simplify to? Well, I just add my numerators. They're both going to divide by 4. So I'm going to add my numerators. It's going to be 7 over 4. Good to go. Okay, x over 3 equals, what's this going to be? X over 3. Well, here, this mean moved down here, and that means the other mean is going to move up here. It's going to be equal to y over 4. Mean swap, that's it here. Okay, so cross multiplication, means extremes property, denominator add, mean swap. What's the one thing that we haven't done that's missing? Well, invert the fraction. Let's see if it's this one. Yep, 3/4 is the same as 4/3 over y over x. Okay, y over x. Hey, another justification of this here too. Check this one out. This is another way that I could have proven the fractions just flip a little bit more quickly is this. X over y equals 3/4. What if I raise both? This is for you who are in Algebra 1 right now. This might be fresh on your mind. Or in Algebra 2, this is fresh on your mind. What if I applied the principle that you're actually able to raise opposite sides of the equal signs to the same power and equality is preserved? Well, what if I raise this to the negative 1 power? Is this the negative 1 power? You guys remember what negative 1 power does to a fraction? Well, it flips the fraction, okay? This would simplify to y over x equals 4/3. The symbol negative 1 for an exponent is actually used for a lot for the inverse here, right? These are inverse. These are reciprocals, right? Reciprocals here. So anyways, another way we could have written that proof, but I need to do that here. Okay, we got a whole bunch of things, classroom exercises. I'm going to take a look to see how long this video is here because, again, I don't have all the time in the world. Let's see, like, I don't want you to just look at an hour. Yeah, it's 43 minutes already, so I'm not gonna do this. I'm not gonna do these classroom exercises. This is your exit ticket, so give it your best shot. We'll look at them, we'll give you feedback. I might film a video, I might have to, but since this is already 43 minutes right now, go do your exit ticket. Give it a shot, give it your best shot. Best of all. All right, bye guys, see you.